So the topic of discussion today is covalent bonding. We discussed ionic bonding in the last lesson, which was basically transfer of electrons from a metal to a non-metal. Covalent bonding is different. A covalent bond is formed when electrons are shared between non-metals. Covalent bond is formed when electrons are shared between non-metals. Okay, so a covalent bond will always be formed between elements from group 4 to group 7, not group 8, because noble gases do not form any sort of bonds because they have complete outermost shells. Okay, so there are three types of covalent bonds. One is called single covalent bond. What is a single covalent bond? It is a bond formed by sharing one pair of electrons. Okay. So how does it work? For example, let's take the example of chlorine, Cl2. Now, there are two chlorine atoms. Now here, when we are going to draw the dot and cross diagram, we're going to overlap these dot and cross diagrams because sharing is happening. So when sharing is happening, it means that no atom is losing or gaining electron. They are sharing electrons. So these circles of Venn diagrams sort of things are going to overlap with each other. Okay, there are two chlorine atoms, and we know that chlorine has how many electrons in the outermost shell? 7. If it has 7 electrons in its outermost shell, it only needs one to complete its outermost shell. So what both chlorines are going to do is they are going to share one with each other. So this chlorine will share one with this, and this chlorine will share one with this. Okay, since they had 7 electrons in their outermost shell, so they shared one, the remaining electrons were to have to write over here 1 2 3 4 5 6 1 2 3 4 5 6. And now if you count, both the chlorine atoms will have complete outermost shells. 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8. So this is what I mean by sharing one pair of electrons. This is one pair of electron. Each electron came from each atom. This one pair of electron can be represented by a single line. So we can write this as this. It means a single covalent bond. Okay, there are other examples of single covalent bonds. For example, ammonia, NH3. And nitrogen belongs to group 5. It has 5 electrons in its outermost shell. Okay, so first of all, there are 3 hydrogens mounted on nitrogen. So let's draw that first. 1 hydrogen, 2 hydrogens, and 3 hydrogens. Okay, hydrogen had 5 electrons in its outermost shell. It needs to share 3 so that 8 electrons, it can complete its 8 electrons. It will share 3 with each hydrogen, 1 with this, 1 with this, and 1 with this. And hydrogen, we know that hydrogen has 1 electron in its outermost shell. It can only share 1. So the outermost electrons of hydrogen are complete. Outermost shell is complete. This is a duplet. Hydrogen always complete a duplet. Okay, so out of 5, 3 electrons were shared, 2 will remain unbonded or unshared. So if you count the number of outermost electron nitrogen has, You can say,
you can see, one nitrogen has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
It has completed its octet. Okay. Again, these Doring cross diagrams of only exhibit outermost shells. So remember that always. Okay, let's do another example of water. Yes, let's just do water. H2O. So, two hydrogens are mounted on one oxygen. Two hydrogens are mounted on one oxygen. One hydrogen, two hydrogen. Okay. Okay. So, oxygen belongs to group 6. It has 6 outermost electrons or 6 valence electrons. Valence electron is another terminology that is used to, call electrons in the outermost shell. Instead of calling electrons in the outermost shell, you can simply say valence electrons as well. So, 6 valence electrons. Right? If there's 6 valence electrons, it needs to share 2 to complete its octet. Okay? So, it shares 2 with each hydrogen. Hydrogen, in turn, shares its only electron. And since oxygen share 2, 4 of them still remain. 4 of them still remain as unbonded electrons. We call these electrons, these free electrons, we call these lone pairs. Okay, then they are bond pairs and then they are lone pairs. They are lone pairs, they are not involved in bonding. Okay, we can also write NH3 like this. These are 3 electron pairs are shared. No, this is actually 1 electron pair is shared with hydrogen. Shared 1 electron pair with hydrogen, it formed a single covalent bond. Nitrogen shared 1 electron pair with this hydrogen as well, it will again form a single bond. Nitrogen shared 1 electron pair, again a single bond, and a lone pair remains. Okay, so for oxygen, oxygen shared 1 electron pair with hydrogen, forms a single bond, and forms a single bond. There are 2 lone pairs remaining on this. Okay. Let's do ethane, C2H6. Now, C2H6, this gets confusing. So, what we can say about this, if I write it in the form of ratios, if there are 2 carbons and 6 hydrogens, we can say for each carbon there are 3 hydrogens. So, let's draw for each carbon that there are 3 hydrogens, 1, 2, 2 and 3, or not here. Okay, 3 hydrogens. A carbon belongs to group 4, it needs to share 4 electrons to complete its outermost shell. It's going to share 3, but still it's 1 electron remains. It needs to be more, it's not, it cannot be a lone pair because it needs to share all the 4 electrons it has to complete its octet. Okay, but hydrogens are only 3, so it can only share 3 so far. Okay, now this is for one carbon. The other carbon will have the same problem. The other carbon will also be having the same problem. Since it's C2H6, it will be having the same problem. Dot, cross, dot and cross. Hydrogen, hydrogen, hydrogen. Okay. Now, both of these carbons will have 1 electron, not spare, both 1 electron unpaired, okay, and it is important that they share it with someone because they need to complete their outermost shell. So what do? They share it with each other. They share it with each other. Yes. Okay, it forms a compound called C2H6, it's called ethane. How can you write this? You can write it like this. C, one electron pair, H, 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 one electron pair, H. Okay. So this was single covalent bonds being formed. Let's talk about how double covalent bonds are formed. Double covalent bond is formed when two electron pairs are shared between two atoms. Two double covalent bond. It is formed when two electron pairs are shared. Two electron pairs are shared. Okay. So let's take the example of O2 here. O2 belongs to group 6. It needs to share how many electrons? It belongs to group 6. It needs
2 electrons in its outermost shell, so it needs to share 2 electrons.
Both oxygens, so they will share 2 electrons. And remaining 4 will, or both of them will remain spare or as lone pairs. So we can actually write it like how much? This is a single covalent bond, this is a double covalent. I can write the structure as this. Okay, this is the Doring cross diagram of O2. Okay, let's take another example of CO2. So there are two oxygens mounted on one carbon. There are two oxygens mounted on a carbon. One oxygen, there is another oxygen. Okay. Now carbon has 4 electrons in its outermost shell. It needs to share 4 to complete its octet. Oxygen has 6 electrons in its outermost shell. It needs to share 2. Okay. So oxygen, if I talk about oxygen, it needs to share 2. So it shares 2 with carbon. Both the oxygens. And rest of the 4 of them, since they had 6, so 4 of them will remain as lone pairs. Okay, what about carbon? It has 4 electrons, it needed to share 4. It will share 2 here and 2 here. Their outermost shells would be complete. Okay, count for carbon 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And for oxygen 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You can write this compound like this. Single covalent bond, single covalent bond. Yeah, two covalent bonds are stacked together. So it would be C double bond O double bond O. Okay. One electron pair means one line. Two electron pairs means two lines. Okay. Don't get confused with this, because by the looks of it, we can say that there are 3 electron pairs being shared, but they are not 3 electron pairs being shared between 2 atoms. Okay, for a double covalent bond to be formed, there has to be 2 atoms sharing 2 pairs of electrons, like in this case. Okay, let's do another example of ethene called C2H4. Okay, how does ethene work? Again, find out the ratio between them. Simplest ratio would be, for each carbon there is going to be 2 hydrogens. For each carbon there is going to be 2 hydrogens. 1 hydrogen and 2 hydrogens. Okay. So carbon needed to share 4 electrons. Carbon needs to share 4 electrons, but it can only share 2 with 2 hydrogens, because hydrogen can only share 1 each. So 2 of its electrons still remain. 2 of carbon's electrons still remain, and same is the problem with the other carbon. Similar is the issue with the other carbon. It has 2 spare electrons. Not spare, 2 unbonded electrons. What they are going to do? Like they did in ethane, they will overlap with each other to complete their outermost shell. As a result, cross, dot, cross. Okay. As a result, a double bond is formed between 2 carbons, because 2 electron pairs are being shared. So we can write it like this. Yes. And this. Okay, so moving on to triple bond, triple covalent bond. You need to know just one molecule for this, that is nitrogen. What is a triple covalent bond? Let me take yellow. Okay, triple covalent bond. A triple covalent bond is formed when three electron pairs are shared. When three electron pairs are shared between two atoms. One example would be N2, nitrogen. So nitrogen belongs to group 5. To complete its outermost shell, it needs to share 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. It has 5 electrons, right? It has 5 electrons. To complete its octet, it needs 3. So it needs to share 3. So 2 would remain in both the cases. Okay? Now, 1, 2, 3. So 3 lines. 1, 2, 3. 3 lines. So
that was different types of covalent. That were actually different types of covalent bonding. Single, double and triple. Now we are going to talk about the properties of covalent compounds.
Covalent compounds are those which have covalent bonding. Right? Okay. So let's talk about covalent bonding now. Covalent compounds. Properties of covalent compounds. Covalent compounds are those compounds which have covalent bonding. So let's talk about their properties. Okay, but before that we need to classify these covalent compounds into two types. There are one types of covalent compounds are called simple molecular, and there are other covalent compounds which are macromolecular or giant molecules. Most of the covalent compounds are simple molecular. If they ask you to write the properties of a covalent compound, you are going to write the properties of simple molecular. Okay? Because simple molecular and macromolecular differ in their properties. So whenever they ask you to write the properties of covalent compound, you're always going to write the properties of simple molecular compounds, which are, number one, they have low melting and boiling points. They have low melting points and boiling points because of weak van der Waals forces, weak van der Waals forces of attraction, which are easy to overcome. Okay, after that question, property number two is that they are poor conductors of electricity. They are categorically poor conductors of electricity. In any state, shape or size, they are poor conductors of electricity. And the third property is they are insoluble in water. Now both of these properties lie for macromolecular as well, but one property of macromolecular is different, and that is they have high melting and boiling points. They have high melting points and boiling points because they have strong covalent bonds. They're difficult to break. Right. So the macromolecules are poor conductors of electricity except for graphite. We'll talk about why. We'll talk about the fact that why graphite conducts electricity. Okay, you should be familiar with some of the macromolecules. One is sand, that is SiO2. The other one is called diamond, and the third one is graphite. You should be familiar with at least these three molecules. Some examples of simple molecular substances can be actually, you can quote any covalent compound like CO2, ethene, C2H4, or NH3, all of these are simple molecular. Most of the covalent compounds are simple molecular. It's just a few macromolecular that exist, and they have different properties. First one is that they have high melting and boiling points. So we need to discuss why do they have high melting and boiling points. So these are the structures of diamond and graphite. Diamond, this is the structure of diamond, and this is the structure of graphite. So why do macromolecules have high melting and boiling points? Let's take the example of diamond. The thing is that
for diamond to melt,
you'll have to overcome these covalent bonds, because unlike other molecules, unlike simple molecules, there are no intermolecular forces in a
diamond structure.
Why? Because for intermolecular forces to exist, there has to be at least two atoms. In the sense, there has to be two molecules for intermolecular forces have to exist. But here there are no two molecules. There is just one giant molecule that is extended in three dimensions. Okay. So if you want to melt a diamond, so you'll have to overcome this covalent bond, which is much stronger than any physical forces. Okay, so that's why this melting point are very high. They have to break the covalent bond. It's a unique case. In most of the compounds that we studied, ionic compounds and covalent compounds,
you only had to overcome the
intermolecular forces. In ionic compound, there were electrostatic forces, and in covalent compounds, there were van der Waals forces. So you only had to overcome physical forces. So which is why their boiling points or their melting points were not that high. Okay, but for giant molecules, boiling and melting points are very high, because they have to overcome a chemical force, a chemical bond, that is covalent bond. Okay, now another anomaly that exists is that covalent compounds are generally poor conductors of electricity. Okay, and then I wrote except for graphite. And macromolecules are also poor conductors of electricity except for graphite. Now let's take a comparison between diamond and graphite, that why graphite conducts electricity and diamond does not. So diamond is tetrahedrally bonded, which means that its carbon is engaged. Its all four bonds are engaged, which means that no bond, no free electron exists here. But when talk about graphite, this is also another form of carbon. Only three bonds of carbon are engaged per atom, which means that one electron is free to roam around. So if you take a chunk of graphite which may have millions of carbon atoms, and for those millions of carbon atoms there will be millions of electrons. If you go by one electron per atom, so there's going to be a lot of free electrons, which will result in conduction of electricity in graphite. Okay, so that was all from the properties. Now let's look at some of the past papers.
So question number one:
in order to form a compound with oxygen, an atom of group 2 element must, obviously it has to, okay. So in order to form a compound with oxygen, an atom of group 2 element, if there is a group 2 element, so you must know that it is an ionic compound. Even if the heading says covalent bonding, it doesn't mean that ionic concept nahi dala isme. So in order to form a compound with oxygen, an atom of a group 2 element must do what? It must transfer 2 electrons to the atom of oxygen. Okay, which molecule contains 3 shared pair of electrons between 2 of its atoms? Which in other words means, which one of these molecules have triple covalent bond? So we discussed that. It was nitrogen. Which pair of elements when combined together do not form a covalent compound? So sulfur and chlorine will form a covalent compound because both are non-metals. Phosphorus and fluorine are also non-metals. They will form a covalent compound. Nitrogen and chlorine are also non-metals. They will also form a covalent compound. Cesium and fluorine. Cesium is the metal and fluorine is a non-metal. So this forms ionic compound. So this would be the answer. They ask you which do not form a covalent compound. Okay, which substance is a covalent compound? The catch is do not conduct. Either when they are solid or they are liquid, they do not conduct in either of the cases. So answer would be B. Okay. Draw dot and cross diagram of ethane. We did that. For carbon dioxide, we did that as well. Explain why solid iodine do not conduct electricity. Since iodine is a covalent molecule, so you talked about electrons here. Why solid iodine does not conduct electricity? Because it does not have free electrons. Free electrons. When heated solid iodine turns directly into gas, use kinetic particles. So you need to explain this change of state. You can simply write the solid iodine will gain heat and its kinetic energy. The molecules will start to move faster and their kinetic energy will increase and they'll overcome the intermolecular forces between them. We did that in kinetic particle theory. Draw dot and cross diagram of Cl2O. So Cl2O means two Cl's are mounted on an O. Chlorine needs to share one, it shares one. Oxygen needs to share two, it shares one with this, one with this. And then you'll have to write the free electrons over. Not free electrons, the lone pairs over here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Oxygen's outermost shell is complete. Why Cl2O has a low melting point? It's a covalent compound, obviously. It has a low melting point because of weak intermolecular forces. Or you can say weak van der Waals forces. Weak van der Waals forces of attraction. Which are easy to overcome. Silicon dioxide has a similar structure to diamond. Suggest why silicon dioxide does not conduct electricity, because it does not have free electrons. You will only talk about ions in ionic compounds. It does not have free electrons. Why silicon dioxide is hard? It's a giant molecule. It's going to be hard because it will have strong covalent bonds. Which are difficult to break. So that's the end of covalent bonding. Hope you enjoyed it. Stay tuned for another lecture that would be on metallic bonding. Inshallah, see you soon. Allah Hafiz.